Our big shot today, he is trailblazer Ted Sarandos, chief content officer for Netflix, who single-handedly is catapulting Hollywood into the future, giving birth to the binge watch, making the wait for next week's episode a thing of the past, and with it, business as usual in Hollywood.
Ready for battle.
Yes.
His digital streamer, now turned big-budget studio, doesn't play by industry rules.
No, it's just expanding.
And A-listers are in.
So this is the office where they say A-list actresses and actors are lining up to meet you.
You see what a mess it is on top.
What's his secret? It's not the business of Hollywood that drives him. It's his passion for Hollywood driving his business. Hollywood's most sought-after media maverick, Ted Sarandos, today's big shot.
So we are here with Ted Sarandos in the screening room of Netflix, where I'm sure there have been extremely huge, big moments that have played out for you here.
It's named after David Fincher. It's the Fincher Room.
This is the Fincher Room. Has he been a seismic influence in your trajectory?
Yes, I would say yes.
You tracked him down with $100 million. I'm not sure he could have turned you down then.
We were instant friends.
Yeah.
And Fincher's House of Cards, an instant success.
Those are the House of Cards enemies.
You want to know what takes real courage? Holding it all together when the stakes are this high.
And for Ted, the stakes couldn't be higher. Netflix was proposing changes consumers didn't like and seemed to be unraveling until Ted's big bet on Frank Underwood undid the damage and not only saved the day, but catapulted Netflix into the future.
If I was making this show, I would not have done it with Netflix. We've never released or created an original brand. We never started an original show on Netflix before, so you wouldn't want to take this, which felt like the crown jewel of television, and put it on guys who were barely doing television. And so what I told them at the beginning was, there are 1,000 reasons you should say no to us. I'm going to give you one reason to say yes, which is I'm going to give you 2 seasons, 26 episodes with no pilot.
Unheard of.
And I will not give you notes.
And $100 million.
It's a big number. And I think the main thing about it was knowing, when they weighed the offer and weighed out everything about it, they definitely didn't want to make a pilot. They definitely wanted to commit to the show. And
was Kevin Spacey all in from the get-go?
Yeah. I mean, he was enthusiastic about it. The desire for change was definitely shared. This kind of what turned out to be kind of a very radical thing about all episodes at once, and David Fincher making a TV show, and Kevin Spacey and Robin Wright being on a TV show.
But how did you know to trust that that was the one to put down, lay down all that money on?
Well, it certainly ticked all the boxes for me, right, and as a project. I was a huge fan of the British original, a monster fan of David Fincher's films, all of his films. Kevin is, you know, a remarkable movie star and a great actor. And to me, it felt like the perfect package. They invited all the buyers in to pitch, and I said, after we looked at the package, and I said, I don't want to go and have you pitch us. I would like to go and pitch David. And we wanted, as to why you should do the show as Netflix. The answer is yes. Let's go. I want to tell you why you should do it with us. What's been great about it, it's almost inextractable, the size of the commitment and the quality of the show. Because if they knew there was going to be 26 hours, they made the most beautiful sets you've ever seen for a TV show. With no commercials, they can create differently. It was the first show on Netflix where we didn't just take the commercials out and put it on. So it was built to be watched kind of all at once.
Binge.
Yeah. Even though it was before the word.
We're survivors.
If we can't show some respect for one brave man and still accomplish what we set out to do, then I'm disappointed in both of us.
I should have never made you ambassador.
I should have never made you president.
House of Cards has caused me many sleepless nights and very tired days.
The show has a ton of fans, but yes. but what's really great is so does Orange Is the New Black and so does Bloodline. I mean, right now, people who are like starting to watch Bloodline and just getting so sucked up into it. Sense8, we launched it. I had 2 people saying, "I'm into the 7th hour of it."
You're the guy that helped me get out of the hospital.
That's right.
What guy?
He's standing right there, and he's a cop.
Jane Fonda told me that she can't quite wrap her head around that how many people have already seen the whole show. And when she meets fans on the street, they've seen the entire show.
Mom, we're gonna find you people to talk to. People who understand exactly what you're going through.
There's a group for wives of husbands who've turned gay in their 70s.
Ted may have masterminded marathon viewing that's changed Hollywood, but he credits Netflix dynamic founder Reed Hastings for creating a company culture of fearlessness.
You can't be afraid to be wrong. It's born out of this Netflix culture that Reed Hastings created.
You're never afraid?
I've been nervous.
What has caused you the most nervous situation?
I think the House of Cards deal itself.
Sleepless night?
Yeah, a couple. I mean, it was because honestly, it was the truth of it is though, the way that after we did the deal, and I sat down and I talked to Reed and said, hey, we did this. Here's what we did. And I said, if it's...
You told him after the fact?
Yeah.
Really?
But it was not... Yeah, it was just what, I mean, we... I mean, I have... He has granted that much, the authority to do that. And I would say, if it doesn't work, then we will have wildly overpaid for one show. And if it does work, right, we could fundamentally change the brand. And so it felt like the right risk-reward trade-off. And that's about the extent of the conversation we had after it. And then I just had... After saying it out loud... I could just breathe a sigh of relief.
It's an interesting dynamic duo that you make because he, for the most part, remains, more off screen. But him giving you the platform, the freedom to take these big risks, how big an influence has his vision, his philosophy, the culture of leadership impacted you?
Enormous. I mean, I can't even articulate it. I mean, I've been very blessed in my life to have great mentors. Reed certainly more than any who can be as generous as a CEO as possible in terms of letting somebody else step up and not just share the spotlight a little bit. He's a brilliant consumer science guy. He's a brilliant engineer. He writes great code. I mean, well, pre-Netflix was quite successful because he does all those things really, really well. And he's deeply passionate. Don't mistake that he's this, nerd that goes off and works better out of the room. He moves mountains in the entertainment business. He moves mountains in the world of education. Moves mountains in government.
But he's also moved mountains in allowing you to change vastly. Forget the outside culture of Hollywood. The internal culture of Netflix, which, from the outside looking in, appears to be. When do you have a boss that empowers you to spend $1 billion and to take risks on your own instinct? And to empower creators as he's empowered you with freedom.
There's this deck that floats around the internet. And the great thing about it is it's real, right? We live and breathe that culture that's in that deck every day. And a lot of people are cynical about it and they read it and they say, oh, those are words on the, that go on a plaque that hang on a wall. But that's really how we run the business. And Reed pointed out to us early on, the talent density issue is probably at the core of all those things, which is how do you run a business as brilliantly and as passionately as you do when you're a small startup when you get big. And really it's about trying to keep the people who have that same spirit close to you. So attract people who are risk takers, attract people who like that environment. We're not looking for people who like tenure. There's no employment contracts at Netflix for anybody, including myself. So that we want people who want to come and do the best work possible, and that's the reward. And in some ways, that's the reward. That's reward enough. But on top of that, we're also very generous in terms of, what we pay the people so that they can do the great work and be happier.
All the people that came to you, you said you didn't want to hire. You said we know how to do it. You can't do that. You can't do that.
Yeah, when early days of streaming, I thought we needed a television executive to run our streaming business, and I probably interviewed 40 of them. And every one of them told me in very explicit detail the things that we'll never be able to do. And after about a month of this, I said, I'm exhausted by this. None of that can be true, but everyone's saying the same thing. So I said, let's just try it ourselves. And there was a guy on my DVD team who was the most kind of entrepreneurial and hardworking and didn't know either, but was willing to figure it out and put in the hours and time to do it. 6 months into it, we were doing everything that those guys said we could never do.
Reed Hastings had to beg you, I was told, repeatedly to take this job in 2000.
Well, it was super unintuitive in 1999 when we met. Took a job with a company called West Coast Video in Video City that was based here, just and it facilitated the move. It was a chain that was in transition. We needed to be able to migrate out of our VHS revenue share deals into the DVD business, so I negotiated the first revenue share deals with Warner Brothers and Sony for our chain.
And that caught the attention of Reed
that
Hastings.
Caught the attention of Reed.
Right. And he came after you and had to beg you.
It wasn't that he was begging me to take the job, he was begging me to open my eyes. Because we met in 99, we had a conversation. It was my very first e-commerce transaction, was to fly to Los Gatos and San Jose and meet with Reed. And it was like another planet. I mean, when I walked in that building, there was a mound of boxes from places like drugstore.com and places I've never even heard of. And people were buying razor blades from a drugstore online. It just didn't, really didn't even click for me. So we had a discussion where he described Netflix almost exactly like it is right now.
Yeah, he said he wanted to, back then, in the 90s, he wanted to change the economics of Hollywood. And he also foresaw that the digital revolution was on its way.
When he told me this, 1999, I remember distinctly because someone had emailed me a South Park clip that felt like it took 7 days to download it. And I go, are you sure this is? And he's, and very often, no, it's this thing called Moore's Law. Look it up. It's, you know, the internet's going to get twice as fast at half the price every 18 months. And every single thing he talked about in 1999 has come to pass. And I wasn't sure that he was right then, but I was sure he was generally right. I had never met somebody as brilliant as Reed, and I've never, or as clear thinking and as confident in the decision making based on this vision that he really has. And it wasn't just hunches, you know, these were data supported things so what he kept saying was, and this was a time after the internet bubble had burst, and there was no IPO promise. And a lot of people that I know had gone into internet businesses and got wiped out. So it wasn't that a no brainer. And what he really wanted was to say, look, this is an amazing opportunity to do what you told me you wanted to do when we met. You want to change the entertainment business? This is how we're going to change the entertainment business.
If you had to describe whatever genius that you think you have, what would you think it is? How would you describe it?
I hope, and I think any of those things, what you just said would have to be aspirational. It is picking the right people who will deliver. Landing on people who, because a lot of people, I think there's no shortage of good ideas, but it is remarkably rare to have somebody who can execute on a grand vision. And being able to spot that, I think, is, if anything's differentiated, I think it may be that.
Do you have a checklist that you go down and say, yep, or is it just all gut?
It's pretty gut. And then I have this other luxury of having all of this data to go back in and kind of either solidify the instinct, or I like to think of it as kind of a data-informed hunches. Well, the world has become data-rich and sometimes information-poor. So there's lots of data, but you have to be able to know what to do with it. And you have to know what to look for in there. There's a lot of people who could have figured out a lot of these stats about Adam Sandler. You had to see it evolve in the patterns in the data to realize that there was a there to keep digging on that one. That, you know, it was conventional wisdom that Adam Sandler movies weren't very international. Our data was completely the opposite. It was completely unconventional thinking. And that's what drove us to want to do this deal with Adam, which was he's for 20 years, he's made a movie a year.
What's it like to be a trailblazer that's upsetting the status quo? Is it something you have to brace yourself for, or does it come naturally?
It's super helpful not to know.
You mean not to know what you're upending because you're just doing what you think is right?
Or? Yeah. So the decisions we make are there's no motivation to upend anything. Like, I think that the great thing is about being kind of, if you can be a creative revolutionary, you have to be able to have a better alternative. It's not enough just to destroy things, right? You have to have a better alternative.
Hey, you've said that you're not against Hollywood. You just think you have a better economic model.
Yeah, I love Hollywood, and I love what Hollywood does for the world. And I do think there's a better economic model for it that will sustain it forever. And
well, let's talk about that. So you don't have to work on a linear grid. You don't have to, you know, get ad dollars. You don't have to rely or live or die by ratings, and you have a bunch of money to spend. You know why you piss everybody off.
Sure. I mean, believe me, I think that not having a programming grid, not having to have a live linear grid, which means that all shows have to be 30 minutes or 60 minutes or in those 30-minute blocks, and shows not only have to work, they have to work at a time slot on a channel where there's 500 alternatives.
You don't have those restrictions.
I don't have any of those restrictions. Right. So, of course, I mean, that I would... I'm sure they're a little envious of that model. But really, what we could have used it for good, or you could use it for evil. We used it for good, which was program for what consumers really want to watch and how they want to watch it. Importantly, I think, is to give that freedom to the creators to create.
Do you think that the business has gotten so far away from the very consumer and the very medium that is supposed to drive their passion anyway?
For sure. I mean, you see it in movies, where I think movies have dumbed down for the audience in a way that, you know, to be more global. The volume of movies that get made, the things that can't get made anymore, that, you know, so people, the audiences don't even have an opportunity to pick a great movie instead of a bad one. You see it in television shows that keep getting shorter to accommodate more advertising, even though it's driving viewers away. I mean, remember a couple of years ago, the fight over the 2 minutes of Mad Men. I think that if you're having those kind of discussions, you're not having the creative discussions, and you're really underserving the viewers. We have the luxury of not having to worry about some of those things. We really kind of refocus on, do people love these characters? Do people love this show? That decision you make when you cannot go to sleep because you have to watch one more and it's 2 a.m. and you know you have a 9 o'clock, that to me is like, that's what's driving and pushing all of this.
The tried and true executives in the town, the suits as we call them, say, yeah, but you won't release your numbers and your ratings, so how do we know if these things are really a success? You're not relying on ratings. What are you relying on?
They're not an actual reflection of the business. So why should I just pile on and do the same thing?
But what is your measure of success? Where do you say this is a success?
They're actually fairly traditional. Relative to how else we would have spent the money, are we getting people to watch? So we have a direct feedback loop with our consumers. We're one-click cancel. So if you're not watching the things on Netflix, you will cancel. That is the right economic model. For me, giving numbers to the press, it's a curiosity for sure, but it's trivia. It's not real actionable data in any way.
One TV executive who competes with you said, Sarandos and Netflix doesn't understand is that there has to be some give and take here in these deals, and that your acquisition of content is confounding. How do you respond to that? Is there compromise?
There is a lot of compromise. We don't get to where we're at without negotiation and compromise. But I don't think that it's my or Netflix responsibility to continue bad models. Right, so there are a lot of times I think that people who own content want to license content to Netflix on the terms that suit their other businesses, and that won't work all the time. So some things we don't have and some things we do have. And so there's some of the things that we try to be uncompromising about because they're important to consumers. A lot of those rules that are probably meant to suit some other archaic part of the business, trying to apply them to Netflix I thought was, you know, not a great idea. So we try to push those things that are important to consumers, and more so than things that are important to Netflix.
So someone like Aless Moonves, who I know as a friend and a mentor, has said, okay, you got lucky out of the box with House of Cards, but that's not the rule, that's the exception, and said that for every Chelsea Handler that doesn't want to be on network, he's got a Colbert who does, and he thinks he's won. What do you think?
Well, one of the things that I admire and love about Les is that he's wildly competitive. So of course he says those things. I was stunned, I mean, as an example, I was stunned that Chelsea Handler would be available because you'd think that all the networks would try to differentiate themselves from one another and not put another 40-year-old white guy on television in late night. And when the opportunity availed itself, we went that way.
Les has said that it doesn't matter what the outlet is, as long as you got the content. And now you're competing with him on content.
Yeah, and like saying things like, you know, like we only have one or two shows. Yeah, we have 13 shows going into production before the end of the year. We're launching 7 shows before the end of the year still. We have 30 original kids shows going up next year. Our programming is not that it's on one show. Our show programs have been nominated for 48 Emmy Awards, have won 13. Golden Globe nominations and wins, Emmy or Oscar nominations. So it's like, I don't know why he loves that narrative. But again, it's just
got
that,
your competitive juices
exactly,
going.
Exactly, exactly. And that's what I think. If there was more of that, that'd be great because it kind of ups everybody's game.
Or totally upsets it, as in the case with theater chains threatening to boycott after Ted's announcement to run the sequel to Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon on Netflix the same time it hits the big screen.
That was pretty big and bold, and you didn't back down. When the fallout comes from that, who do you think wins?
If it's between the two of us, I think we do.
Because, why?
Because we're making these decisions on behalf of consumers, and they are not.
Do they lose ultimately?
If they continue to hold on to that model, they will. So you cannot, I don't think you could build a sustainable business that is based on denying people what they want, if you know they want it.
Because you're saying the experience is completely different. When you want to stay home, you're going to watch, but when you want the big, massive experience, you're going to go to the theater.
I love going to the theater. I think it's a great experience. I can't do it all the time.
Is this the Kodak dynamic at play? This is how we do it. We're not changing our ways because we have concessions, ticket sales. We have all this opening weekend. Yeah. This is how we base our success and our profit.
Well, when you're on top, you don't want to let it change because there's nowhere to go but down. And when you think about the way people watch movies, most people watch most movies at home. But most of the money that is spent, you know, watching them in that theater. And the way it's all carved up is, you know, the attendance of theaters seems to go down a little bit every year, and the prices go up a little bit every year, and that's what's driving the growth in the United States and in most of the developed world.
But you see where that's going.
Yeah, it's going to become a smaller and smaller business. So why not? You can change that, or you can embrace it. And I think one way to embrace it would be maybe ticket prices should go up more dramatically, and you could accommodate things like rumbling seats and bigger screens and smells in the theater and all those things. Just really make it like into a thrill ride.
Like which, Epcot theaters.
Yeah, and I think is a natural trajectory for this versus say, no, we're just going to lock down access in a world where people can get anything they want whenever they want on the internet and then scream about piracy. I mean, to me, it doesn't make any logical sense to deny people what they want and scream about piracy. And then use the internet to create international demand for a movie, and then don't use the internet to fulfill that demand. To me, I think it's a more natural thing to focus on. What do consumers want? They want to see movies when they're thinking about them, not a year later. They're telling us in big numbers that they'd like to watch them in this Netflix subscription model, but yet the theaters want to lock down access for, you know, in many cases. In France, it's the law that if a movie's in a theater, it can't be on Netflix for 3 years.
Oh my God.
The law.
So can you envision as a futurist a time when you'll just stream direct into the theaters for the big events, have House of Cards for 6 months and one binge watching in one theater, just you direct, bypassing it all?
The bigger focus is what's happening at home is getting so great. I mean, screens are getting bigger, the 4K, we're streaming in 4K, so on a big screen TV in 4K, it's actually higher fidelity than a movie theater today. So I think that experience from watching it on a phone on your way home and then picking it up and pushing play it when you get home and watching it on the big screen.
More comfort. Control, more options, more choice.
And that will win out, I think, over...
Now we know.
It is the only media that's unaffected by the internet, really, right? Is that first theatrical window.
Well, that's why they're fighting you so hard to keep it.
Yeah.
All right, so we know what you do if you're running AMC. You'd make the seats rumble and we'd smell the rainforest. What about the networks? How would you rejuvenate the network experience?
I think what NBC is doing is really smart. It's really doubling down on live and must see. I got to see it now. You know, the 40th anniversary of Saturday Night Live, I mean, to me, that was the Super Bowl.
So the event television model.
Event television. I think those live, whether or not it's, you know, live musicals or whatever it is, I think it's the liveness.
What about cable? What would you do if you were running a cable channel to stay relevant in the face of a Netflix?
Well, I would say more and more great content. They are doing a lot. I think the cable channels are doing a lot in terms of we're all upping each other's game, right? So FX and AMC, you know, up the, you know, in response to HBO, made better and better programming. We came in, I think we upped everybody, you know, again, in terms of wanting to make better, more competitive programming. So now you've got the top tier of cable, pay and basic, and Netflix all creating great programming and everyone else trying to scramble to catch up.
That's an interesting point. You have said all along that while there are many competitors and you respect them all, that HBO, because of its 130 million plus subscribers, was your main competitor. And you said your goal was to become more like HBO before they became more like you. To take on HBO?
Yeah, I mean, I think when we were talking, when I said that, it was really meant, it was an articulation of who we were, who our competitor was. So HBO has a gold standard, I think, for original programming. They've been for many, many years.
But have they been
waning
lately?
After that. Yeah, I mean, I think I think they've been off of that mark for a while.
You think they're chasing you? You think they're chasing you in content?
I don't know. It's up to what do you love? I mean, I'm a huge fan of Veep. I think Veep's a great show. So I think that it's not like they're not doing great things. They're doing great things. I think we are too. And what I said was back then about getting to be like them before they became like us was we have to get great at original programming before they get great at the technology of being direct to consumer. Basically having the website work, managing credit card relationships, doing all the kind of amazing technology that we have. About 1,400 engineers who do nothing but make Netflix work around the world on 700 different devices that have all different delivery capabilities and all different internet speeds, that when you push play, Netflix dependably works everywhere in the world. That's what I meant, that HBO is going to have to get good at that to compete with us. Mm-hmm. And that we'll have, and we'll, in the meantime, we're going to have to catch up with them on original programming. Our biggest competitor would be piracy. So we have to be better than free. And that is what's really inspired us, not to be better than HBO or better than anyone else. It's been better than free. How do you make a product that people are willing to pay for when they can get things illegally but easily free?
So you've gone into the kids space, Marvel, you've got Disney churning out a bunch of stuff for you coming up. You have gone into Latin America in a big way, have a show in Mexico. You're looking at China, even with all their censorship issues. Where will you not be, and where is your cap?
Probably North Korea. I guess we probably won't be in North Korea.
Probably not soon, but they may be into you. Let's hope not.
I would say never say never. Like we're not focused on live and sports and those kind of things, because like I said, I think that's something that TV is really built for, and it just works beautifully. We're really at our core about on demand. So if we start dabbling into live programming, I think it confuses the consumer about what our brand is about.
Where do you get that sense, the big cojones, if you will, to trust your ideas that they're right?
You know, maybe it's because I never felt like there was that much to lose. You know what I mean? My background is very, very humble. My father was an electrician. My mom was stay home. We
had one of five kids.
One of five kids. We're very kind of lower middle class upbringing. So it wasn't like I was, you know, that my Ivy League education was on the line if I made a left instead of a right. On the downside of being young and not having kind of great inspirational, leaders ahead of, to follow, I didn't also have, didn't have anyone to disappoint. So the things that I was doing them out of passion and out of desire to do better. But it really didn't have as much on the line as a lot of people.
Ted's rise to Hollywood big shot was not the usual trajectory. He credits his days as a video store clerk in Phoenix and the largest DVD distributor in the nation as priceless preparation.
So how do you think working in the video store back then actually informed the decisions you make today?
When I didn't go off to college and stayed and ran the stores, and the guy basically handed me the keys to the chain and said, wanted me to run things. So we did payroll, we did marketing, we did negotiated leases, certainly the programming, which was my favorite part of it, going through the upcoming things with the sales reps from all the different studios.
Oh, so you got to choose movies you put on your shelves.
Yeah, yeah.
And so how that many, was the beginning.
And more, you had to forecast how popular they'd be so you knew how many copies you'd need.
So how'd you
and
make those decisions?
This is pre-algorithm, this
right.
is pre-everything. So really it was watching. So we would not only would I watch everything in the store, so I had a real sense of what was what. So I really paid attention to what people, when they came back, oh my God, I love this movie. Thank you so much for recommending it. Some people can remember, box scores. I remembered those things and faces and likes and dislikes. And it got to a point, honestly, when the store was busy that people would wait for me so I could suggest them a movie. And
you were the tastemaker.
Yeah, and people really put a high value on making a good choice for some odd reason. I mean, it wasn't that high risk a choice, but people put a very high value on going home with something great. So that's what I put a lot of the energy into.
It's kind of like a Slumdog Millionaire. The guy's entire life history and experience led to those moments of actually being able to win the game. Do you feel that way?
Yeah. Well, it's funny because you think about a lot of those things really did start in that store, in those stores.
So you love politics, you love television, you love film, you love people, you love the creative process.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you're the luckiest man in the world doing what you love, getting paid so well for it?
Every day. I mean, I bounce out of bed because I have to come to work because I just think I'm incredibly, incredibly fortunate. I've met all my heroes. I don't think anyone can say that. And most of my heroes that I grew up admiring or in my world every
Norman
day.
Lear?
Norman, for sure. I mean, that's to me, like, I can't imagine. I wondered one day how many times I've seen the name Norman Lear. You know, and I've told the story before, but I was such a TV nerd that when I watched the episode All in the Family when Mike and Gloria moved away. So when my sister and brother-in-law moved out of our house and moved away, moved out of state, I cried because I was thinking about Mike and Gloria.
How has he encouraged you to keep trailblazing anew as he did?
This was a guy who just kept pushing back. I think Norman had more faith in the world than the networks did, and that we would be able to handle it. And without him pushing it, who knows, you know, the social change that would have happened at what pace without it being on television every day.
What has been his greatest advice to you?
Oh, just to keep pushing. Like, don't get comfortable. Just keep pushing yourself and keep pushing the limits as far as you can.
When we look back at visionaries, we have so few. They come around just once in a while. So one that comes to mind for me is a Ted Turner. And he recognized that the 6 o'clock news was no longer the dinner hour for American culture. Yeah. And yet the networks did not change the evening news time.
And the value of movie libraries. He was, really.
Do you identify with him?
Yeah. I mean, who wouldn't want to? You know, I think he's really changed television in a way, in a really profound way.
But in the same way, you're confronting the same things.
Right. He kind of created
a
24-hour cycle of things.
And they thought he was nuts. They called him crazy, disrupting the business and integrity.
But the 24-hour news and then the 24-hour cartoons, I mean, all those things that really came from there was that it changed the expectation of entertainment. Mm-hmm. And he did. I asked him one time, I met him years ago. When was it? Probably more than 20 years ago, at this home video event, and I said something to the effect of any advice, and he says, never lease a car.
That's what he said.
That was his advice to me. Never lease a car.
Well,
it'll get you in the habit of spending money you don't have.
You know what? That in some way might have planted the seed. You don't need to license anymore. Create your own content. You never know.
And I remember in high school meeting Ed Asner for the first time, which was a big flashpoint in my life because it connected entertainment, politics, journalism for me. He was hugely helpful to me when I was a young writer. After I did an interview with him, kind of in the height of his Lou Grant controversy. Mm-hmm. He came to Phoenix for a local Screen Actors Guild meeting. I was a writer for the high school newspaper. And I staked out the meeting, and I saw him on the way in, and I asked him if I could get him to sit down for an interview. And he said, I can't now because I'm running late into the meeting, but as soon as we're done, I'll give you 30 minutes. I was like, great. And the meeting went on for like 6.5 hours.
Oh my God.
And I left and came back. And when he came out the door and saw me sitting there, he thought I was there for 6.5 hours. And he felt so guilty that he gave me a phone interview because he had to leave. And then from that, just introduced me to, I mean, a million people who I went on to do interviews with or connect me to things that were important. But it really gave me an inside view of the entertainment business, and it really whet my appetite to want to do more and be closer to it and more in the center of it.
One of the dynamic partnerships that we see in the press is you and Harvey Weinstein. Obviously, your collaborations have now been extensive. How is he most... I know he stood up for you in France when they were, you know, accusing you of taking away film subsidies.
Very dramatic moment.
Very dramatic moment.
France,
that was he came to your defense. But his alignment has been, powerful. How would you say he's most influenced your trajectory?
I think he's a great reminder for me of the passion. So he loves movies. Harvey makes great movies because he loves movies.
He says the same about you. The reason why you've been successful is you've got good taste.
Maybe that's how we found each other. I mean, honestly, and again, I would say the same thing about, the first time I saw Pulp Fiction, thinking, seeing a non-linear piece of storytelling and really understanding what they were doing. And then again, I'm reading everything I can about Harvey, I'm reading everything I can about Lawrence Bender, and now Lawrence Bender actually introduced me to my wife. So that's how your life, can be changed.
I'm so glad that you made that bridge for me, because Ambassador Nicole Avant, a political triumph and force in her own right, former ambassador to the Bahamas. She was monumental in electing the president here in California, raising a bunch of money for him. They say alongside every great man is a phenomenal woman, and in your case, certainly the same. How does she most empower you. You're a power couple in this town.
She, Nicole is phenomenal in every measure. I mean, when I, first time I laid eyes on her was at an event for President Obama. He had just got the nomination in 2007. And the, and I remember seeing her running this event. And she was bouncing from table to table, and she was telling everybody what they had to do and who was going to do what and where the president of the United States would and wouldn't
That's
go.
That's right.
And then she got up and introduced them, and I just remember thinking to myself, who is that? And then just kind of by happenstance, Lawrence Bender, who was a host on this event too, invited a group of people to dinner. And she came walking in, and I was sitting at the table, and he said, do you know Nicole? And I said, no, I've never met her. And he goes, oh my God, you have to know her. And switch seats. And we switched seats. And I sat and talked to Nicole for 3 hours straight.
And that was it?
And that was it. We never stopped. And
you got married very quickly.
You know, we did everything quickly because it was great. I mean, we...
You know what you like.
And we talked about everything that people, couples who are together for 10 years don't talk about in that first 3 hours. And...
How did you ask her to marry you?
So after we were dating a while, and after the President Obama was elected, she was offered to become the ambassador to the Bahamas. So on 4th of July, she was in D.C. doing her training to go be the ambassador, and I took her, she did not know, but I bought tickets for this cruise on the Potomac to watch the fireworks, and during the fireworks, I dropped to a knee and asked her to marry me. I didn't want her. I wanted her to go into that role focused on everything, all the right things, and we were going to be great. So,
and now you are literally the young power couple of Washington and Hollywood, and you've made this incredible bridge. So if you had to describe the dynamic between you, are you more Frank and Claire Underwood? Are you President and Nancy Reagan? Are you Bill and Hillary Clinton?
You know, Nicole, she has taught me something that's really powerful.
You're not going to answer that, are you?
No. She's taught me the power of yes. And how, I mean, I remember very early in our relationship, she had this conversation with me about what makes America great. And that America is a country about yes. Yes, we could do that. Yes, we could try that. Yes, you could do that. And that everywhere things go badly is when people mistake the power of no. And the people who basically drive all their power from no eventually failed miserably. And it was such a great observation. So being able to empower people to do the things that they need to do, that you can really make a change in the world. And we focus on our relationships with people all throughout this town, in business, in music, in movies and television, in politics, the arts, is all focused on those people who are about yes.
If you had to say, what are your top three moments that were just a total wow? I mean, when you're with Brad Pitt and you're with the president and you're with all these major icons, what is a big moment to Ted Sarandos?
Well, I mean, some of them in Netflix life and just in life.
Both.
So in our life together, Nicole and I were in a very small group that were in the White House with the president on inauguration night. I am a guy who's lived a huge history buff. So to me, that was an out-of-body experience. Having President Clinton and Leonardo DiCaprio together introducing Virunga in New York at a screening was, and then following the two of them, was pretty remarkable. Seeing David collect the first Emmy for House of Cards, these are pretty big moments. They don't stack up to the great moments with, you know, watching Tony and Sarah, our kids, you know, having great success and learning their way around things. But I think in terms of milestones, those are probably the three milestones that would come to mind.
You have a home in Beverly Hills and in Malibu. What is your favorite thing about LA? You could live anywhere.
It's the weather, obviously. That's the kind of easy one. But I love living in a company town. I love that you run into people who are, you know, in your world, and it's very, makes it feel very small, even though it's very huge and very busy all the time. I love the small townness of it too.
Favorite restaurant?
Capo in Santa Monica.
Ah, yes. Favorite movie theater?
We probably see the most movies at the Landmark at Westside Pavilion. But I love the IPEX Theater, and they're pretty phenomenal. Just a recent discovery, though.
So to the young men and women out there listening to you, who have something they want to sell, they want to make, they have a dream, how would you most encourage them to get their stuff seen and made in this crazy town?
There's been this great change in digital production. where you don't need a lot of money now to really do amazing things.
The main thing if you want to do is just do it and get some version of it in front of people and let them see what you can do.
And most important, he says, do what you love. At heart, Ted's a true fan, and that's what many say makes him rare.
Where do you think that you got that rarity, if you will?
I don't know, to be honest with you, because I think I'm doing something that I love. And I think that's so, I mean, it's underrated in the world to find the thing that you love. Not the thing that you want to do or the thing you think you'd like to do or the thing you fantasize you'd like to do, but the thing that you really love. Maybe the result of horrible parenting, watched a lot of television and saw a lot of movies all the time and really loved it. I mean, in a way that I felt like I had a relationship with these characters and I wanted to know them, I wanted to meet them.
Are you emblematic that if you do what you love, your dream will find you and you don't have to chase it?
Yeah, and it won't be the way you think it's going to happen. I mean, the idea that we went, when I joined Netflix, in 2000, so almost 15 years ago, we were mailing DVDs around the country. And we were my focus was mostly on how do you make discs that don't break in the mail? And then how do you get revenue share deals with studios to get more copies of discs? And all those things that were drivers, but knowing, you know, you always had that first conversation in the back of your head, which was that this is gonna be a purely digital business and we just have to get from here to here to get there. And that's the, you know, like everything else in life, you have to put in the work, you have to put in the years. Mm-hmm. And then we always treated the notion of doing original programming as the icing. You know, we have to make a great cake first, and then that will be the icing. And we didn't invest in original programming until we had 25 million streaming subscribers. So we did the work, and we put in the hours, and we put in the time, and then really investing in House of Cards was not. We always talked about that would be some, like, you know, big reward. When it really, I think of anything, it was a way to seed the future that we almost had to do it.
Yeah. Right. Anyone upcoming next?
For competitive reasons, I couldn't tell you.
We'll leave it right there. Thank you for taking the time. It was incredible to get into the inner workings a bit and take the time to really get to know you a bit. Thank you.
Thanks for doing this. Thanks.
Ted Sarandos, our big shot on LA Magazine. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Giselle Fernandez. See you next time.
And cut. Awesome.